Hi, Ire.
Hi. It's nice to meet you.
You too.
So welcome to Prismic Studio. So basically what we do here is like we interview people like in the web development community, people who give talks, to learn from them and also like give the opportunity to our users and our audience to learn about things like JavaScript, HTML, CSS. Basically it's web developers. So they're very curious about what's new there and how you build things. So you're in Paris for DotCSS, right?
Yes.
How did it go?
It was really good, actually. It was my first time at the conference, so I didn't know that much about it. But I really liked the idea of people just attending and they don't know anything about
what you're going to talk
yeah,
about.
Yeah, what I'm going to speak about. And it kind of like is a good thing, but also it was making me like change everything in my talk in the last day, because I was like, nobody knows what I'm talking about, so I could like just completely change anything. So that was the thing. But I really liked the format, especially it being like 18 minutes and everyone is just so they're just there and they're watching you. There's like no laptops, there's nothing like distracting them, so it was a really great experience.
Yeah, it's pretty short, so people like are really focused.
Yeah,
but
exactly.
It's longer talks that can be a bit hard
to
follow.
Yeah.
And you weren't like afraid that some other like speaker would like take the same topic as you?
Well, we were sure that they weren't going to talk on the exact same topic, because I think the organizers spoke to us first to get an idea of what we're going to speak about. But I had like two different jokes that were spoiled by other people. So I don't know, next time I should speak first. Because like, yeah, but I think I found a way around it. But yeah, that was funny.
So what did you talk about?
Yeah, so I talked about, well, the title of my talk was Writing CSS in 100 Years,
okay.
Which it was actually 1,000 years first. And then I was like, wait,
that's too far.
So that's another thing I had to change, like the day of the conference. Because I was like, wait, no, that doesn't make sense. But it's basically just about like best practices and just how the concepts of writing CSS will probably be the same in 100 years. So things like progressive enhancement, accessibility, performance, all these topics are probably still going to be important. So it's just about, like I said, best practices for writing CSS.
Okay. Yeah. We'll do like a separate video on each of these topics. So
okay.
Like that.
Awesome.
Also, people who weren't at the conference could have like ideas about that. But can you tell us a bit more about you? What's your journey? How did you become like a front-end developer?
All right, so where to start? Well, I'm a self-taught developer, which I'm not even sure how I feel about that term, because it's not like I'm really self-taught. I just didn't go to university for it.
Mm-hmm.
So I actually studied psychology for my undergraduate, then law for my master's, which was just like completely irrelevant, I guess, to what I'm doing right now. But it was something I always did as a hobby. But the thing is, at the time, I didn't know that computer science was even a thing that you could study.
Okay.
And I didn't know it was something I could make a career out of. So I was just kind of playing around with it. But it's when I was doing my master's that I like discovered this world. And I was like, okay, I need to try and do this. So when I graduated, I just started doing, trying to teach myself, and started doing freelance, and then it just kind of took off from there.
And how did you teach yourself? Like, if someone is like doing a different job and wants to like try and like learn software development or computer science?
Yeah, so the first thing I used was Codecademy, which I still think is like a really good resource. First, it was free, so it was very easy to just jump in and learn like a new thing. And then after that, I would start like I would start with like a project in mind. Mm-hmm. Oh, I wanted to build X thing. And then I would just try and do as much research to find, okay, what do I need to learn to know how to do this thing? And that's just kind of how you go. So you just like read articles, you learn how to Google things, which is like really important in this job. And you just kind of go from there. And the really great thing about the web is that it's very open, and a lot of people share the things that they do. And even if they don't actively share, you can still go and like look at their website and look at the code.
Yes.
So there's no hiding anything. So if you see something that you like and you want to know how to replicate, you just have to like look in the code and you can do that. So that's basically how I learned.
And you started with like JavaScript from the beginning, or you learned different languages before?
Well, I mean, I started with just like HTML, CSS,
okay.
And JavaScript was only for doing like interactive UI things. Mm-hmm. And then as like I matured more, then I started using JavaScript in okay. like frameworks and things like that. But at the beginning, I was just trying to make like a website. And I was making like my sister's website because she's an artist.
Okay.
And she needed like a portfolio website. And yeah, it was it was just so bad. I was using WordPress, but yeah, I didn't really know how to use like the... I didn't actually really know how to use WordPress. So I remember that like for the navigation part, I created like all these different pages, but I didn't know how to create a template. So I had to like copy and paste the navigation on every single page. And then my sister would be like, oh, okay, I want to add this one thing. And I'm like, oh my God,
I need to go
and edit the code in every single page. So yeah, it was a lot of like learning through. And I was like, this can't be the way that people build websites. And then you start Googling and then you realize, oh, there's a better way to do it. And yeah, just like trial and error, basically.
And with WordPress, you needed to learn a bit of PHP or you just...
Yeah, exactly. Like my second or my first like really big job was working with a media company and they were using WordPress. And that's what really, like, I learned so much, especially like about PHP. I didn't know anything about PHP. Mm-hmm. I was just like, okay, I need to do this thing. How do I do this thing?
Okay.
And I don't know, today I will still say I don't know PHP, but like I can build a pretty good WordPress theme and like plugins and stuff.
Okay.
And it was just from like hacking together things, and maybe it wasn't the right way to do it, but ultimately... It worked.
It feels that lots of people who work on WordPress are still like having this impression that they hack lots of things.
Yeah.
Like making plugins work with each other and like having the themes.
Yeah.
So, okay. And so after this agency, what did you do after that?
So I worked there for I think about 2 years. And after that, I grew a lot in that particular role. And I felt that I wanted to work for a company outside of Nigeria because at the time and a bit still now, there weren't that many like really great companies that I felt like, okay, I can really go and learn from other people. Mm. So I was like, let me try and look outside Nigeria. And then I got a job with IO, which is a company based in Germany. Okay. And I was working remotely from Nigeria. Oh. So that was really cool.
Okay. Yeah. IO is the company who has like Chrome extensions or?
Yeah, so their main product is Adblock Plus.
Okay.
And that was cool because I was like, I use you guys all the time.
Me too.
It's like, yeah, I love it. And it's funny going from a media company to like an ad blocking company because it was like almost, oh, enemies, I'm going to work for the enemy. But I was like, nah, I like you guys.
Yeah. And like for a company like that produces things like Adblock Plus, I kind of think that maybe they serve everyone everywhere. So like I said, you needed to make like websites that work in every language for different types of browsers. Was that like the big challenge in that job?
Yeah, it was actually really interesting working with them because internationalization was a big thing. So I think coming from working for a company in Nigeria, we are much more focused on the website is going to be in English, but we need to make it work on budget devices and things like that.
Okay.
But then with IO, it was like most people are going to be using the latest device, but then we need to support like X different languages. So that was a completely new like paradigm that I learned how to work with. And that was really interesting because I previously had never worked with... I had previously never tried to make a website work in multiple languages.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, oh, this is... crazy. There's like so many different considerations. Like I never even considered, wait, like I might need to support a right to left language. And I was just like, oh, it's kind of like mind blowing. But again, like I really learned so much from doing that.
Okay, cool. And so today, what are you doing?
What do you mean?
Like what company do you work for?
Oh, right. Yeah. So now I'm working in my own company. So myself and two other co-founders created, it's called Buycoins.
Okay.
So it's a cryptocurrency exchange for Africa is what we like to call it. We're currently operating out of Nigeria. And it's also been kind of different as well, because we've been a lot more focused on mobile.
Mm-hmm.
So we've had to use a framework like Ionic, because I'm still like a front-end web developer. How do we make mobile apps? So we kind of have to use that kind of thing. So that has also been interesting.
Okay, yeah. I discovered Ionic during .js actually.
Oh, like, interesting.
The founder of Ionic was there, and yeah, he gave a talk about speak. Like supporting React, not just Angular now.
Yeah.
So it's interesting. Mm-hmm. Cool. And just one last question before we go to the next video.
Mm-hmm.
I read an article from you on CSS tricks, mm-hmm. and I saw that you listed different things you're excited about. One of them was CSS Houdini, and I personally didn't know about it before I read this article.
Mm-hmm.
So I was curious if you could explain to, like, pretty simply, let's say, what is it and what is going to change for people writing CSS?
Okay. So Houdini is... I'm not sure why they gave it that name, but I think it's because it's like magic.
Yeah.
It essentially is a way for us to write our own CSS values, right? So instead of like display flex or something, mm-hmm. we can put display and our own type of layout, right? So the way it works is that if you're aware of, for example, service workers,
mm-hmm.
service workers allow us to kind of, I guess, hook into the network layer, I guess. But with Houdini, there are many different APIs that allow us to hook into different stages that the browser needs to go through to actually like put the CSS and the styles on the page. So for example, like I mentioned with the display, there's like a layout API,
mm-hmm.
and that will allow us to hook into the way the browser builds layouts, and
okay.
we can build our own. So we popular examples like trying to create the masonry layouts,
mm-hmm.
which is trying to think. I don't think I can explain what it is, but it's basically just a different type of layout,
okay.
right? So, like I said, instead of putting display flex, you can put display
anything.
Masonry, or I mean, that's not exactly the syntax, but essentially that's what you do. So why I think it's really exciting is because it will essentially allow us to, like I said, write our own CSS. But if you think about it, we don't necessarily need to be waiting for browsers to implement things anymore.
Yeah.
So once we get to a stage where pretty much all browsers support Houdini, then we no longer actually need to wait for them to support X or Y, because we can just build it ourselves and put mm-hmm. it in the browser. So that would be really empowering, and we can like basically do crazy stuff. But yeah,
cool. And do you have an idea of when it will be live, like for everyone?
Yeah, so like I mentioned, there are many different APIs, so mm-hmm. it's not just one Houdini API. It's like I mentioned, the layout API.
Yeah.
There's a paint one that allows us to like draw images and things like that. So they are all kind of moving at their own pace.
Okay.
I think the paint one is what's most ahead at the moment. But I think we're still a while away before we're at a point where, like, it's just standard.
Okay.
But you can definitely use it in certain cases even today. Yeah.
I'll definitely link to this article you wrote
yeah.
so that everyone can read more about it.
Awesome.
I think you gave the same example of masonry, and, like, there's a link also to,
oh, okay.
to
yeah,
learn and
yeah,
see
that's
about
true.
It.
Yeah.
Cool. Well, yeah. in next video, I'd like to touch on, like, different things you talked in the same article.
Okay.
Serverless and Jamstack. And
awesome.
Also Fugu, I guess. Also,
oh, yeah.
that you're excited about.
Yes.
And like, I'd be interested in knowing more.
Mm-hmm.
Cool. Thank you.